ist online. Okay, so there would be no place at the moment where I would love more to be than in Reykjavik. Nonetheless, I'm here and participating on this hybrid event. Our topic for tonight is to discuss a little bit about mentorship. And I really hope that there's something in for you, and you can always ask questions via the chat box. And I really hope that we will come to a lively discussion. I just want to share a few comments from mentees and mentor relationships that I had in the past. And number one, what I would like to talk about is the saying that you always, most of you know probably, is compare and despair. It's one of my messages to the mentees that it is not so important that you always compare yourself, your career, your abilities with others. My message is that mentees should reflect on their own strength, not compare them with other colleagues and their career paths all the time, and also set yourself your own goals. Not saying, well, he needed 3 years for a promotion, I should make it also in 3 years. Maybe speed is also not important. Maybe it is more about achieving what you want to achieve, and maybe time and role for you is a little different. So discuss with yourself, with your mentor, with your colleagues, what is really important for you. And oftentimes we spend so much time in dealing with problems that just arise along the way when we completely forget why we were on that path in the first place. So focus on the target, on the goal. And if we lose that focus, then the result is that we only have a very vague or even wrong idea of what's really important to us. So always remember that, number one. Second, you should continually learn to perceive present reality more clearly. Oftentimes people are so caught up in and trapped in counterproductive relationships because they continue to pretend everything's fine. But the truth is very often, and that can also apply to professional life, the truth is it's not right. The choice of partners, and in professional life, it means also where you work, plays a major role, especially for career-conscious women. So if you want to reach the goal of your desires, it would probably be good if you know where you have to be for this goal. So people who follow this are characterized by a special determination that stands behind their visions and their goals. These people see a vision as a calling and not just as a good idea. I always also say, let the others say no. Other people can say no to you. So sometimes you have to express what you want. You have to make clear calls about your desires and then find allies to get through this goal. And when you have learned to recognize that changes happen all the time, and that you use those changes to fiddle around with your goals and your strengths and how to apply to the new situation, then it's much better to take that change, as always, as an opportunity instead of fighting these changes. Changes are inquisitive. And it's always good to strive to see this reality as, yeah, as clearly as possible, really. People who are successful, you can often see they actively use change in their professional environment, and they change with it. And they include changes of their position in the company also in the light of what they want to change for themselves. Another discussion comes there on whether it is worth sometimes to take a sidestep in instead of just climbing the ladder up. And I can say a sidestep could mean that this is not a detour. It helps you to understand that you are on the right path. And it could also give you really necessary additional knowledge and experience on the next step. You live to learn and you never arrive. So the journey is basically the goal, you could say. Yeah. And strong people usually are well aware of their own ignorance, of where they are incompetent or what weaknesses they have. But that doesn't conflict with their own self-confidence. So this part of, you know, knowing who you are, this is what I would summarize in this, not comparing with others, but compare with yourself. Compare and despair. In German, we say, vergleichen bringt gleichen. That's a little strong, but I think I made my point. Number two, input for this leader's talk is how to define and pursue your own goals. I mean, any personal vision that you want to pursue probably comes from within, and it's directly linked to your own personal values. So this personal vision that you might have is a specific place of arrival, an imagine of a desired future. There's a parallelism of the vision, so what we want, and the picture of the reality. So how can we get to what we want? So that creates this, motivation to bring those two positions together. Personal mastery also means learning how to create and maintain this creative tension. So in this context, learning does not mean that you absorb more information, but rather that you expand your skills that are necessary to achieve your goals. And this is truly striving for your life. So it's a term very often used in these times, lifelong learning. But you can see this in strong leaders that they never stop learning. And learning not only means the big things like an executive MBA on top or whatever. It's also whether you have an abo on certain podcasts or whether you have permanent sources of keeping your knowledge up to date. And trying to learn a new language could also be part of that. So all these rapid changes that we see in life, in society, in the transformation of entire industries, and they all need new acquired knowledge all the time. So there are studies that say that students that finish university have knowledge that will be useless, half of that in 3 to 5 years after the graduation ceremony. So that's when it starts. But you know, people my age in the mid 50s also have to learn all the time, and I can assure you that this is the message I clearly make when I have mentees to say that this really never stops. Yeah. And I can also see sometimes that people have problems to talk about their vision. And that sometimes even applies when their vision is clear, but they don't want to talk about it. They want to keep it to themselves. And maybe this is also some kind of uncertainty, but when you talk about it, it also means you have to defeat it, maybe, in the eyes of someone who has a totally different opinion about it. And in defeating your own position and explaining why you believe this is feasible and this should be your path, you learn also. So it could be an opportunity to learn when you talk about something like your vision, your strategy that you want to apply, and how clear your vision of the future is. So the reality always is not your enemy. It's always your ally. So with these comments, I might conclude on this second point, defining and pursuing your own goals. I see that there's not yet something in the chat, so I would continue a little bit. Maybe the third point we should discuss today is, is a career really fair, and to what extent is it plannable? Well, my own experience, and I think most of you share that, is a career is very difficult to plan for, and there are always many coincidences involved. And in one of my favorite movies, the Star Trek series, they say they were in the wrong place at the wrong time, and that's why they became heroes. And I think, when I look at myself, I could also say I was at the wrong place and at the wrong time, and that's why I became a board member. Some careers are boosted by a crisis. Some careers are ended by a crisis. So there's always this this element of unplannable events in it. And in Europe, especially in Germany, and even more so at Volkswagen, parents or grandparents sometimes started already working in this company, and they stayed there for years and decades, and very often their whole work life, 40 years, 45 years. And this kind of lower job rotation that the generations before us have experienced, that doesn't exist for many people. Now it's a past fading, globalized world. The expectations on a career, they change every decade. Maybe in 10 years, everyone who has not stayed for a 3 years period, at least in China, is not seen as a top candidate for a board position. Who knows? So you see that also in US companies, that certain universities are seen as leading and a must have for certain career paths. And then you always find the exceptions, people that don't fit into the scheme and still continue in their career. So what can you do? And maybe what's also good advice in a mentor-mentee relationship is that keep your eyes open, not only around yourself, but also social networks and career platforms. Open up with new positions. And sometimes it's also good to ask yourself the question, how big is my willingness, or am I really ready also sometimes to do a switch that is a complete switch, yeah, where I change not only the job, but also the company, where I change country as well. And what are the questions that I have to answer in this respect? What about my work-life balance? How important is this for me? And are there certain times in my career, family-wise or personal reasons, that influence my career? At some point, a young lady, I was at the university in a discussion with an MBA class, and then a young lady raised her hand and she asked me, Miss Werner, what do you think is the right moment in my career to become a mother? And I said, well, I would say the best moment for that is 9 months after you got pregnant, because it's not so easy to make that connection. I mean, my son, for example, was born. I was still a student. Probably it would not be a good advice for a lot of you to go that same path, but it worked out for me. It was a full wish as well. My husband and I, we were ready for it. We wanted it that way. So listen deep inside you. How will the career be influenced by decisions in your personal life? But don't let the professional life always, you know, overtake control about each and everything. Let me just check on the chat. I see a new message here. You touch on planning one's career. It seems that focus is required. Once such an important career decision has been made, how does one transition one's life? Experience suggests that personal goals are not aligned with original career choices. Yeah, well, it really depends on the horizon of the goals that you set yourself. For example, I always ask myself in January, what do I want to achieve this year? And then at the end of the year, in December, I look, what did I achieve this year? And then I ask myself, if I not achieved what I wanted to achieve, is it because I should correct my goals, or should I strive to achieve what I wanted to achieve next year? Is it still valid? And of course, a lot of influential factors come into that. The career choices, as you say, I mean, the company could be either growing or being in a difficult situation. If the economic situation of the company is not easy, then probably promotions are not on the list, or they go for lean management and jobs are cut, management positions disappear that you wanted to have. Of course, that's why it's good not to think that you were a failure only because the goal was not achieved in the time when you thought you would achieve it. That's the time to review all of that. And that means, I hope I answered a little bit what you thought you had in mind. The focus doesn't mean you cannot change direction. It means that you should always know what you wanted so that you have something to go for, and also something to change. You know, in the army says in the battlefield, they say the plan is valid until the fight starts. And of course, after that, you know, the situation can change any minute. And it's the same with your career. You probably have a very well laid out plan when you graduated. But once you entered your professional life in a company, it can, you know, open up in different areas. So what could be important when you plan your career? Maybe that also fits into that question. So first, let's talk about some measures that you can plan. First, as I said, as part of lifelong learning, which training courses you want to attend. So you can find out what further training courses are for you of interest, where you want to grow. Maybe finance for non-financial people is for you, or IT experience. Even in the legal department, we now have bots and artificial intelligence and so basic fundamental knowledge of the digital world is helpful. And maybe it wasn't touched in your university times. So the second thing, very important, is go to network meetings. There are often entrepreneur breakfasts in many cities where you can meet, or you can get in touch in the morning before work. One of the initiators is, for example, Business Network International, a global network of entrepreneurs. That could be something. The third thing that I really recommend is to maintain a profile in the social networks. This is not so important that you talk in a social network, LinkedIn or Xing or wherever, about everything you do, but that you ask yourself, what is important that other people see I'm caring about? Yeah. So for me, for example, I often write in LinkedIn when I engaged with students, or when I had very specific moments with my direct reports and risk management and compliance, or about general achievements of the company. But there are many other aspects in my professional life that I don't put in the social networks. So the fourth point is check out the market situation on a regular basis. Yeah, check out job portals and at regular intervals, or really see how your profession is still in demand and whether you have to take a turn. I mean, probably 15 years ago, a lot of marketing students left university with the specialization in digital communication, things that in these days probably everyone does by themselves. So when you see that certain knowledge that you focused on plays a role for you, then provide yourself with trainings accordingly. But if you also see that specializations that you had are fading in relevance, then look for a second foot to stand firmly on the ground. Yeah. And the number five in planning your career is don't give priority always to the money aspect. It should not be your own priority. Salary is very important. It's, you know, basically also important how your personal life and your working life, you know, go together. But really think twice about giving up a job that you feel comfortable in only because you can earn somewhere else more money. Money and a career stage cannot make up for the environment. It could also mean that sometimes employers pay more as some kind of pain relief because you are expected to work 70 or 80 hours each week, and then sometimes it could also mean that it's better to take a sidestep instead of being unhappy in a new job with more money. So that would be the third part of our discussion today. We had compare and despair. Then we discussed about the goals, and the discussion kicked off now by the chat was how plannable is your career? Is it fair? And how can you align your career when your experience suggests that your goals are not aligned with the career choices? Maybe we take another little break here for the next question. Someone asked, if interests no longer align with current career, then lifelong learning can help direct career training and lead a sidestep. For example, what could be a good example? If you were in IT and maybe you were very good in software, that is now replaced where there is a migration to a new system and you are not the expert anymore in this system, so your skills are not asked. So you can either try to become an expert or a special user or an administrator for the new system so that your experience grows over time. Or if you see that there are so many others around that are well ahead of you in the new system, you could say, well, maybe I'm going more from the IT side to the business side and to the processes that are maintained by the system, because very often the processes are more stable, only performed in a new system, so that you're more, maybe your sidestep could be to go from the IT department to the procurement department, because by maintaining the old procurement IT system, you are so good in the processes that with a little extra help of trainings in negotiation skills or whatever, you would find that procurement processes would be a good sidestep, and then you grow again. And by being on the business side, you can ask all these tricky questions to the people that roll out the new IT system. And at some point, maybe you move back into IT. So I don't know whether this is this kind of example that you were looking for, but it was the first that came to my mind. Thank you for the feedback. There's a new question. How do you approach a job change if you do not have a formal background on the subject? I believe in a good story. If you can make it a good story why you want to go there and what are your skills, your soft skills that are easily applied to this new job, that could really help. For example, if you can prove that you are a quick learner, that you can bring people together, that you may only know 10% of what's needed in this job, but these 10% of is exactly what other people are always lacking that know the other 90%. So try to listen, build your own story, and make it sound. Yeah. And the more authentic it is, I think the easier it will be to convince someone to take you in a position where on a factual basis, you would not fulfill the requirements. I have done so myself. I have hired people that were, really strange on paper. I had a situation where I hired a person that was 8 years in Guatemala, helping on a mission for with social workers, And she came back and she applied for job as my secretary, basically, missing all the formal qualifications. And I thought, well, she will definitely have this stress resistance that I will find nowhere else. And I was absolutely right. And she was so good in organizing their work, overcoming obstacles, and I've never regretted that decision. So, I'm sure in other situations, when you have a good story that convinces people, it's worth the effort. As long as there's no other question at the moment, I have a fourth point that I would like to bring into this discussion today. In order to boost your own career, it is important to have a good open relationship with your boss. And for that, it is important that you know how to give upwards feedback. How do you give your boss feedback? If feedback of your superior is perceived as you wanting his job, it's probably not the boost for your career. So, structures and interfaces that we are not aware of could really hold us captive. And as a boss, I must say, I'm very, very grateful for everyone who gives me good and valuable feedback. And sometimes I also get feedback that isn't very helpful. If you develop that skill, upwards feedback, it could really help you. It also means you sometimes have to deal with the goals and the fears of your boss. So you have to know him as a person a little. And it doesn't mean you have to like him, and you don't have to like all your colleagues. I mean, they are colleagues. They are not, living as roommates with you. But it's the respect and the fair treatment and also sometimes admitting that a person is difficult for you to work with, that there's someone you can't stand in your private life, but you're making all the efforts to work with the person, is sometimes good for your boss also to know that there are tensions that you try to overcome, that you are professional in that, that you know yourself, and that you also know where you have problems. And there's a sentence also from Peter Drucker, the founder of our modern management theory. He said, few people realize that in the end, they can and must only lead one person, and that person is themselves. So if you can lead yourself in a way that it is also visible to your boss, that you can also provide him also with additional knowledge about himself, where you think he is overlooking something. So basically that you are able to press the right buttons, as we say, then it is good for the career. And to discuss with your boss maybe openly what kind of feedback is helpful for him, and is there maybe a certain time of day that he prefers to have informal conversations such as feedback? Is it the second coffee of the day, or what is it? It shows that you care, yeah? And I think that could also be relevant for the career. And it's also very often an issue that I touch in my mentoring relationships, because it's relevant. I mean, a feedback to your boss could be, for example, Mr. Sowieso, you never keep eye contact. it makes me sometimes feel insecure. It makes me feel ignored. I'm sure you don't mean it, but this is the way as I see it. Yeah? And or maybe you can say, well, you have asked a lot of questions in this meeting. Are you not happy with my preparation? I perceived all these questions sometimes as a sign for me that I should be more content and have a different way of explaining things. Can you give me some input in that? Or maybe it's the other way around, that you ask many questions and your boss does not understand why you ask all these questions. And then it's also important that you make clear to him that you are looking for appreciative feedback, and that this is just your way of trying to get to know him a little better, try also before you start giving feedback to a boss that you hardly know or that's not so clear to you, observe your boss impartially, how he is in contact with other colleagues when you are new to the department. Look what are the, let's say, unwritten rules, try to get more clarity in that. Oh, I see there's another question. When we interview for a job or transfer to a new role, we should ask questions that will allow us to get to know the new or potential boss. Yes. There are generally questions that no one can really, think that they are confrontational. For example, if you say, how would you describe your leadership style? Is there a certain meeting policy that you like? How is punctuality in this area? Is it when a meeting is set up for an hour that no matter how many questions there are, I should stick to an hour, or are you more content focused in this area? There are many questions that you can ask that are just showing that you just want to observe a little bit of the style, how people deal with each other. But you could also be more, let's say, set back a little bit. You could ask about, the average duration everyone is in the department. Is there a high job rotation? Is this how the company wants it, or is it more than they want it? Have there been certain factors that have contributed to that? Did the department grow or shrink in the last 2 years? How did this influence the culture, how people work with each other? And, I wouldn't ask too many questions directly to the boss, and, are you a nice guy? Are you a nice woman? I would make it more questions, around it where you see already and how comfortable they are in answering it. It tells you already a lot about the culture that you have to expect, and whether this is a healthy corporate culture that allows that almost every question can be asked without fear, which is important for a healthy corporate culture. And if you cannot ask every question already in the interview without fear, so then maybe it's not the place you want to work. I think this kind of questions also show that you take it serious, that you not only read the balance sheet of the company and say, you know, I know this is your strength and this and here I fit in, and I think to show interest in the way they do things over there basically is not wasted time in the interview. You should really do it. Yeah. Okay, I hope that answered this question. I mean, we are all, we still have a little time left. Currently, there's no additional question in the chat. I mean, leadership also has been influenced by the COVID-19 pandemic. So leadership in digital times is, of course, also something that is in everybody's mind. And, you know, I don't want to leave this out for tonight in case there are also questions that your mentees or you as a mentor or you just as a leader are dealing with. So if there's not another topic of more interest, then just let's talk about some of these digital times and the impact. I believe it will not turn back to the old normal. The new normal is something with more hybrid formats like today, more mobility of people, more digital work. And the only thing that that I believe will change is really the tools. I think when the pandemic started, there were some tools around like these video chat formats, etc. And of course we used them and we got experts in how to use them. No one ever intended them for this excessive use as we do it at the moment. So maybe next time it will be totally different. You know, we all create avatars of ourselves and we literally walk into a room and we can see each other, and our avatars can back each other on the shoulders, and it will be totally different, more augmented reality wise. And I truly believe there will be a lot of development going into better tools for digital collaboration than what we are used at the moment. But for our employees, as a manager, it is really, really hard, especially for employees that joined the company in the last 18 months, probably have seen their boss after a year for the first time. They miss the steep learning curve that you have by all the chats over the coffee machine. And to create an environment where they still feel as being, you know, fully integrated into the team, that is not easy. And I have seen this myself with some of my colleagues. And so it's easy to maintain a team that has no changes in the COVID-19 time, but it's not so easy to deal with all the normal job rotation that happens as well. So that means as a manager, I saw that I had to explain more what I want to see, to ask more questions also, who is willing to learn what, who is also keen maybe to experiment with new ways of doing things. And also our failure culture had to be different. We had to accept mistakes in a different way. If you lead a team always from the distance, then you also have to be curious and willing to learn and go also sometimes with with more front loading into the team so that they can really plan their own work with a better work-life balance so that they also have a gain from the situation and not only the loss of relationships. A lot of digital technologies, Volkswagen provided very good trainings or web-based trainings for everyone. Sometimes you could see that more the employees took those training opportunities than the leaders. And I can really recommend leaders when new tools come on board to go through that pain and also to manage and master those changes, because it just makes this time more valuable for everyone in such a video conference when there are no technical difficulties on any side. And technical skills and leadership skills need to be developed in this time, as I said, by both sides. So it's virtual platforms, but it's also how, for example, executive coaching for leadership in the digital age could work for some of your direct reports, for other leaders that report to you. And then also reverse mentoring is a good tool when you feel you want, for example, one of these digital natives to help you with things and show that you develop those programs, develop with these programs, and that you also, you know, playfully want to learn some stuff. We also tried a lot of gamification in some of the learning experiences. That was really good. So I think that the digital world now and also the hybrid world will have some management skills on management tasks that will continue to exist, but the content will change. The first one is that as a manager, you always have to drive change. That is also true for a digital leader and even more. The second is that you have to recognize achievements. And that means if this is increasingly done in a virtual world and in changing constellations, then you have always to be aware that the employees' need for feedback have not reduced only because you see them less often. The third thing is that digital leaders really should promote collaboration in a good way, pay attention to this team spirit in a virtual meeting, also do exercises together in that, and also getting employees to speak in a video conference is sometimes even more difficult than in a real meeting room. So, and whenever you have the chance, bring physically your members together, because you know, personal encounters are also in this world, from my point of view, irreplaceable. The fourth point is continue to employ, develop your employees, and there could be many ways of doing that. So many universities have gone digital now, so there are more courses, also free courses available. It is such a boost also for the opportunities to foster a learning culture for a manager. And the fifth thing is that no matter what the format is, as a manager, you always have to make decisions. So that means the collective intelligence of your team is behind you. You have to use it. You have to, you know, motivate them to bring up the input. But at the end of the day, making decisions is also a leader's job. And at some point, people need to know whether a decision is still in discussion or whether it's made. And now, you know, we go for it. And and the sixth thing, which, you know, we have discussed in many different areas today already, is as a manager, as a leader, as a digital leader also, you are the one that has to give orientation to your people. You know, the world is quickly changing and technologies are also changing. What you want, you know, as the focus for your team, not getting lost in the detail or, you know, not seeing the tree in the woods anymore. That's the orientation your people need. Sometimes describing the bigger vision and specifying this corridor through the woods in which employees can move freely and elaborate, but not getting lost. I think that makes you a good team player, that makes you a good leader, and it also keeps your team together and keeps also the psychological safety that they don't feel lost and, you know, sometimes forgotten in their home office. So the cooperation is key here. So these were the 6 points which, you know, probably give a good end to the discussion: driving change, recognizing achievement, promoting collaboration, developing your employees, make decisions, and give orientation. Here's another question in the chat. I'm asked, do you yourself have or had a mentor? Yes, in every step of my career, I did have a mentor, and I don't want to miss it for a minute. Sometimes I deliberately searched for it and asked someone, you know, would you agree to regularly discuss with me in an open discussion some points? Would you feel comfortable in doing that? It has always been a great asset. Sometimes these were people in the company, sometimes it were peers in a totally different area of the company at the same level. And in one instance, it was also a person completely outside to my professional work, to my company, but very, very inspiring. So 8 minutes left. If anyone has still a question, then I'm happy to answer that. Otherwise, I would say it was an honor for me that you took the time tonight to discuss some of these topics in our leaders talk tonight. The Reykjavik Global Forum I attended in the number one and number two edition directly, and I really hope to see a lot of you again in Reykjavik at some point.